Welcome to Rope Dropping Knowledge, where we guide you through the magic of Disney.
Hey.
Hello.
I was just crying. I'm sorry. My voice is messed up.
Crying?
Being bullied again.
By who?
Christina. She's sending me avocado pictures and stuff.
Oh, yeah. It was a shoe. It was out of avocado shoe.
That's horrible. That's taunting. And she's a teacher.
See?
If I was a student, she'd be in trouble.
Now you're known as the no avocado guy. So that's you.
And so she sends me avocados.
Yes.
I'm not gonna call her out too much because it's the week before their wedding. So I'll give them some slack. It better be a traditional, like, nice wedding with no avocados and Asian dishes. That's what I'm saying. I haven't seen the menu yet, so I don't know. Have you?
It is a traditional. There's no.
That means no avocados.
Right.
Right. So they want their laissez. No avocados. All right. But seriously, we have a giveaway going on. And it's still going on. It ends on March 26th. I keep saying that like I'm for sure, but I think that's correct.
I think you're right.
Saturday, March 26th, which is, oh, wow, that's this Saturday. There's a good thing that we're mentioning it because this is your last chance. So anybody who has a favorite Disney property picture spot, you need to direct message us that to Facebook or Instagram or both if you want two entries. If you want to win a Fuji Instax Max mini camera.
It's not mini, it's a camera.
Well,
a backpack.
Well, it takes mini pictures.
Oh, yeah.
So it is actually called a mini.
Yeah.
It says so on the box. Oh. Mini, but we used to call Polaroid pictures, but this is the Fuji version.
Yes.
Version. And we're going to give you a 10-pack of film, so you could just start snapping right out of the box. And we're also giving away a Mickey Mouse Loungefly size, not Loungefly, but Disney product Mickey Mouse backpack, mm-hmm. Small backpack. Mm-hmm. So this is for springtime, picture spots, more picture spots to be taken. And you must be 18 years or older. Like we said, this ends this Saturday, March 26th. Man, this month flew by.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. March 26th, 11:59 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. And you must be 18 years older and live in the United States.
Yep.
All righty. So, oh, man. We got a lot to talk about. But before we get into any of the more controversial stuff, I just want to talk about some park stuff.
Yeah, Disneyland reservation availability for Magic Key holders.
So a lot of people notice this.
Better.
Yeah, and I don't know if this is because of an ongoing lawsuit, because I haven't really heard an update on that. I do know that the Dream and the Believe, that's what we have, right? I forgot the name of my own pass. they're still not being sold, so that's probably why they can make some of these moves. But there's a lot of other speculation, but just to get down to what it is, for the first time, there was some availability, a lot of availability in March, and I think it's extending into April, where there are some dates that Magic Key holders had, some of them, that single-day ticket holders didn't have.
Could it be like a spring break thing?
That's what some people are saying. I guess we'll have to see if this lasts longer than spring break. I think maybe. So there's one thing that a lot of people are saying is that Disney is finally, well, first of all, the market, you know, because of what's going on in Europe right now, the entire stock market is not doing that great. But Disney's stock is down. Remember when I used to complain because it was all the way down to like 140 something?
Mm-hmm.
Now it's like 138, 39.
Yeah.
So even after that huge earnings call, they had a big drop. And, you know, that could be for a number of reasons. But it's not like it's a big surge with, you know, the Omicron thing is kind of over. Some people are speculating another surge might be coming But
yeah,
because
there's one in Europe and Asia.
But at this moment is a good time to go. So go to the parks. So I think what they're recognizing is what I said all along, but we don't know if this is true. Your diehard guests, the ones who are magic key holders and stuff,
are over it.
They're going to get you. No, they're the ones that are. They're the ones that are going to have. What's the number one? Well, I always ask you this question. When it comes to business, what's the most important thing? Exactly. Cash flow.
Yes.
So, yes, you could court your kings and queens and people who drop thousands, maybe sometimes tens of thousands of dollars per trip, but you can't ensure that they're going to keep coming back.
Mm-hmm.
They might go once, drop 30 grand. That's great. It makes one quarter look great, but they may not come again. You know, because if some people who have that kind of money have the whole world as their option, they might just decide to go to Tahiti instead of Disney. They might just, you're competing with the entire world when you're trying to attract that kind of customer.
Yeah.
You're not Bentley. You're not Rolex. You're Disney. And Disney's supposed to be for middle-class families.
Yeah.
And so when you start excluding middle-class families, you're going to eventually hurt your bottom line. Yes, you can get a big boost. Like it's, and I think I even compared it before, like, it's like not, you know, what do you call it? Nitric oxide or nitrous. You remember in the car when you hit it? Yeah, you get a good bang out of it. But for an endurance race, it's not good.
Yeah.
You know, you get one push and that's it.
Yep.
And so I think maybe they're realizing that, oh, you know, the economy's been going up and down, you know, post-lockdown. And we're having some good times. We're having some bad times. We need consistency. That's what businesses really want. Mm-hmm. We want consistency. That's why every product you want these days is trying to add a subscription. You know, I went to CVS. Somebody's trying to sign me up for like, I was buying like a candy bar.
Yeah.
And they're like, oh, do you want to join our care program? It's only $10 a month. And it's like, everybody wants you to have subscriptions. And it's not just because people think, well, it's more money. It's not just because of more money. It's because you're going to forget about it. And like, I forgot to turn off my ringer. It's because you're going to forget about it. And that money's going to keep coming out your bank account or credit card every single month. And that's a sustainable, consistent income for that business.
Right.
That's what magic key holders do.
Mm-hmm.
Beyond the price of their magic key, the actual pass. Yes, they're going to come. They're not going to spend as much, but that money's going to be spread out over 12 months. So every time we go, we spend money, and we don't buy a spare jersey every time we go. We don't buy,
but we still spend on food and
food.
Yeah,
you know, we spend money. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't go there and drop. I think less than.
Actually, I think the magic key holders are the ones who buy food, money, spend money on food and stuff, because I see families who are not magic key holders, like you kind of can tell they're from out of state.
Yeah.
And they're like bringing on like a whole loaf of bread and the whole like the whole package of ham, deli meat, and the whole.
You're saying that they don't spend money, or they do?
They don't spend money on food because they brought their own food, and they sat in, like, it was a family of 10. They sat in the thing and started assembling sandwiches.
The magic key holders or the non-magic key holders?
The non-magic key.
Oh, okay.
I'm saying the magic key holders are the ones who are spending money on food.
Yeah, because we go there the same way we would go to, like, get, like, Starbucks or something.
Yeah,
or, you know,
it's like, it's something like, oh, we must have this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And even the family we talked to who's from Oregon, they're like, oh, we're not really into food. We're just here to whatever. You know, we brought snacks. So it's like,
yeah,
we're the ones spending money in there, not the tourists.
And I think they might be realizing that.
Yeah.
We're not going to buy the $600, you know, Heidi Klum ears.
Right.
But, yeah, we're going to get a Hot Link corn dog probably every visit. You know, or something like that.
And we would be the ones who buy the Heidi Klum ears because we're the fans, the diehard fans.
Yeah, but I think the type of people who buy the Heidi Klum ears is somebody whose, like, wife casually mentioned, you know, they make, like, you know, $700,000 mm-hmm. plus a year. Their wife casually mentioned she likes Disney films, and he bought her that, you know, for their anniversary, and everybody oohs and ahs, and it's like, you know, it's not really. I don't even know if diehard fans buy those things. I think it's more, you know, I think diehard fans are the ones who are like, like, oh, they're giving out magnets. And
we must try this new cold brew.
And why they're there to get, you know, the magic key magnet or whatever, sunglasses or whatever. Yeah, they're going to drop $50 on food.
Yeah.
That's like, what you need. That's the core of your business. And
we
I think they're realizing
that. We must try these new churros. We must try this new cold brew, this new drink, all that, you know.
It's like you were saying about the Galactic Star Cruiser. It's like, okay, once all the initial people go, what's going to happen?
Yeah.
That's what we need to see. I'm not worried about their sales like in the first 3-4 months.
Yeah.
You know, the first quarter, you know, yeah. I want to see how their sales are next year, you know.
Yeah.
January 2023.
Like everything, Disneyland reopening was a trend that everyone.
Right.
Everyone came out of the woodworks to go to Disneyland. People who don't even like Disneyland.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's like, why are you going? Like, it's like, oh, it's because it's just opened, you know, reopened. So, yeah, that was the hype or the trend when it first reopened. But, yeah, the trend always, like any trend, it dies down.
So we're going to see if there's some they start giving, you know, Magic Key holders a little more respect as far as the reservations. And maybe there's going to be a different relationship, you know, going on. But, again, that's just speculation. But we will see. We will see. And we're really going to see what's going to happen because a lot of people, I mean, like I just said, how March went by so fast.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, March, April, May, June, July, 5 months will be a year. That's when people start renewing.
Yes.
We only have 5 months till.
Like April 30th, right? Was when it.
No, August. No. August 25th.
Okay, April 30th. When
so
it opened,
5 months from now. Actually, 5 months from today, pretty much, almost, is when the Magic Keys came available. So the renewals are going to start coming. And usually people renew a little bit before. So when we see the, you know, July, like late July, we'll start to see how many people are renewing. And that, so that's another thing. Maybe they're just opening it up because they know renewals are coming up pretty soon. Because they because this wasn't something that what people were buying all year long. This was like I said before, usually you had it spread out because they used to have annual passes for decades.
Yeah.
Now they went away and then they came back all at once. And then the people who wanted them kind of bought all at once.
Yeah.
So maybe they want to get that big renewal pot redone. Yeah. Because if that goes down.
I think a lot of people will renew, especially with the two passes not being sold out or paused. They're going to be one grandfathered in.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, Disney World is not selling passes to non-residents. But the people who've had it kept renewing. Can still renew.
Yeah.
So
that could be another thing. Maybe they're just like, but then again, that's still a sign of respect. It might be more short term, but yeah. So we'll see. All right, what do we got next?
Will Genie Plus just become a paid DOS?
That's kind of what I was thinking. This is nothing that's in the news or anything. It was more of just kind of an opinion I had because if everybody starts using Genie Plus, because the lines, I mean, there was Genie Plus lines this week that were like 30 minutes. And it varies from day to day, but I'm just thinking if Genie Plus becomes the standard, becomes the status quo, it's like, okay, we got it. That's just something that we have to get when we go. Then basically, isn't it just paid DOS?
Well, with DOS, you have to register and stuff. And
yeah, but I'm just saying, you know, the actual, well, yes, you have to register ahead of time, but I mean, as far as its functionality.
Oh, yeah.
Like you're basically just paying. So you don't have to stand in line.
Yeah.
Because if your wait times are going to be, because I think it was a couple days this week.
Oh, I see what you mean. If your wait time is going to be an hour, your return time is going to be an hour. Like that. Because that's how DOS is.
Right.
It's like whatever the standby line is now, just come back.
So if your wait times, I mean, it still might be better than standby, but if you're, but some of the Genie Plus return times were like 2 hours.
Yeah.
You know, and that was during the week.
Yeah.
So. If it becomes that, then basically you're just going to have, everyone's going to start getting Genie Plus and it's just going to be like DOS. Just a paid DOS.
Sometimes they want that because they want you to walk around and spend money.
And maybe that's their master plan. You know? You know, and maybe that was their ultimate plan always, you know. I don't know. They don't seem that organized these days, but they could be. Yeah. But I don't know. What do you think? Is that you see that happening?
Maybe.
Yeah. I was kind of wondering because people like Disney, again, hardcore fans like us, we're going to continue to go.
But even when Fast Passes were free and then in Disney World Max Passes were free, there were still standby lines.
No, I mean, I'm not saying standby will go away. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is the standby is just going to be ridiculous.
Oh.
And so the people who, so now Genie Plus is going to be the normal.
Yeah.
So, but the one thing, and Genie Plus has seen increased sales. That's continued to increase. The one thing that hasn't increased is the a la carte, though. So I think people are thinking more like we do. Like, we go there, and it's kind of like, nah, we're not going to spend $20. I mean, we've been on Rise of Resistance 9 times.
Yeah.
I mean, total, counting from when it opened and, you know, after the lockdown. So it's kind of like when we go there, if we're not going to... We did stand in line for Web Slingers and got in pretty quick.
Yeah, it was only like...
It was 14 minutes.
40 minutes, but it was only 14.
Yeah. And that was like at 10 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I think that, yeah, for most people who are just, especially Magic Key holders, they're not going to pay $20 for something that they used to just ride.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even though it was kind of a challenge to get on and it breaks down a lot. If you've been on Rise of Resistance 2 or 3 times, it's kind of like, you know, the only time you're going to really pay for it is if you have like, if you're bringing friends or family members who've never been on it.
Yeah.
And then, yeah. And I think those are the people who are going to pay for it. But they, yeah, people aren't really.
And also, like, we've been starting in Disneyland. So if you try to go on Rise of Resistance anytime after noon.
Well, we've been starting a California Adventure.
Yeah, we've been starting DCA, I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah, so anything after noon is kind of a risk with Rise of the Resistance.
Yeah.
Like, even if you wanted to buy it when you are able to park hop after 1, yeah, you could, but I'm like, well, it's probably going to break down, so.
Yeah. So, you know, we'll see, but that's not looking that great. And then they put a hold on the Avengers ride.
Oh, yeah, the Quinjet. Due to lack of funding. Yeah. After they had just announced their how many billions they've made.
I know. So that was going to be the other a la carte ride probably at DCA. And then
the new one, the next one will be the Runaway
Railroad, but that's not going to be finished till next year.
Yeah, but it'll totally be before Avengers.
Which is weird because it started after. You know what I mean? The renovation of Toontown may be done before the completion of Avengers Campus, which is already open.
Right.
They just started the renovation of Toontown last week.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, they've been working on the Runaway Railroad for a while, but even that started after.
That was announced, a while.
Yeah, so that's weird. But, you know, we don't know what their logistical issues are. Yeah. And every ride's different, so. But, yeah, I was just thinking, okay. Now, I know people hate us, you know, getting into all the political stuff, but this is Disney news right now. This is what's going on. So it's like we can just not talk about it or whatever. And actually today we're actually going to bring you kind of like two sides of, you know, not our side or somebody else, but two different groups of Disney
cast members.
Yeah, I mean, we'll talk about that in a second.
A different group, but
yeah.
I guess they exist.
And then there's also some drama after that that has nothing to even do with politics. Well, it's kind of political, but not really. But we'll talk about that, too.
Oh, that?
Yeah.
It is because everything is politics now. I mean, you know, so it's like it's hard to be like, oh, remain neutral. Like, I don't know.
Well, it's hard to say don't talk about politics when anything you like, if you post something, if you post like, hey, I had
had a sandwich today.
Yeah. And people be like, well, was it vegan? Was it gluten free? I mean, you know, it's like somebody.
And then if you say it's vegan, like, oh, that means she's an anti-vaxxer or something, you know, like, remember we had that convention last time we were at Disney.
Yeah.
It was so packed at our hotel, like crazy packed because conventions are back.
Mm-hmm.
And it was some natural products convention.
Mm-hmm.
And I just assumed it's Natural products. But then I started going, natural products? As in, they're not vaccinated? Yeah. So I started putting on my mask. So see, something simple like that can turn political. Oh, I don't put on my mask. I don't trust y'all. So,
anyway. But that was your assumption. Nobody said anything, though.
I know, but I figured, okay, natural.
That's an assumption, but I don't know.
But anyways.
So let's get through this quickly.
Okay, so what happened? Okay, so everyone knows about the bill. So then all
the
of a sudden,
Florida.
Bill in Florida, all of a sudden on March 22nd, on social media, every single Disney segment posted the same statement, just with different colors in the background with the rainbow Mickey, but different, you know, order of the color, I guess. And this is the same day of a walkout, but the statement was basically the statement saying how they support the LGBTQ plus community.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the same day as the Disney employees walking out of the company headquarters in Burbank in protest of the, you know,
right,
of the thing that's been going on in Florida, or not in Florida, but
which I didn't think was going to be that big. But I mean, as far as nationwide walkouts, but you know,
I guess if it was nationwide, because I don't know if anyone in Buena Vista walked out.
I think there were some. I think it was like
Buena Vista. Why did I say that?
No.
Lake Buena?
Whatever.
Florida.
Florida, yeah.
But the headquarters, whatever's left of them, did walk out.
I think there was some small protests.
In Burbank, yeah.
I think they're just small pockets, yeah.
And so there was that. And then somebody reportedly, I don't know how this leaked, but I don't even know if it's true, but it was reported that Disney executives rejected pleas from Disney Parks experience and product leaders, which is headed by Josh D'Amaro and includes him. So they had encouraged that they should, before all this happened, they encouraged their executives to denounce the controversial bill. And over 150 companies signed this human rights campaign letter denouncing the bill. And so it was encouraged that Disney also sign it. But corporate executives kind of like told them, nah, we're not going to sign it.
Right. So, they said the quote was they were rebuffed.
Be rebuffed.
Right.
By corporate leaders. So.
And again, it's always like, I know it sounds like I'm always ragging on Disney's executives and stuff, but it's not so much that I do feel for them in the sense that, I mean, it's not, they get paid plenty of money and all that, you know, what executive for a major company doesn't. It's more that, you know, again, they're in the feelings business, and so they need to understand, and I think this is what Chapek's issue is, and so again, I don't think he's a bad guy. You know, I think that he's just not, and I don't know if we're going to talk about this in a little bit.
He's not well-rounded?
What the quote, well, from the CNBC article was he's not, doesn't have emotional intelligence.
Ah.
Right?
That makes sense.
And so, maybe we'll talk about this a little bit today too, but I'll just incorporate it right now. So there's a big story, you know, CNBC, the business channel, NBC's business channel, was saying that there's a big rift. And I didn't really think about putting it in because we like, you know, there's always been a big rift kind of between Chapek and Iger, right?
Yeah, not like a, kind of like something that's known but not really made a big deal about.
And then they were talking about stuff that was like old news.
Yeah.
You know, the only thing that's really new news about that is that, kind of like my position where people are still calling me for my old organization about HR issues. There are executives, and it's not just cast members, but executives who are calling Iger still saying, hey, you know, help us with this. You know, what do I do about this? You know, still going around. It's not even around Chapek because that would be going to the board, right? Mm-hmm. It's like going outside the company because Iger's no longer an employee and asking them to help with Chapek.
Yeah.
You know, or what do we do if Chapek does this or does that, you know? Some of them are even saying, asking for advice and like, you know, hey, I got a backup. I got a safety job lined up in case this continues because they don't even think the sustainability of Disney is good under Chapek's leadership. So
for them to think that, that's got to be, because a company like Disney, you're never going to think they're going to go out of business.
Not going to go out of business, but it's more of like.
Like they're not happy at their jobs. They won't be happy anymore.
Yeah. I think a lot of people think like, you know, the term like toxic environment is just means like bullying or sexual harassment or.
You
know,
yeah.
No, a toxic environment could just be that no one listens
morale
to you.
Morale is low.
Yeah. Morale is low. No one listens to you. You see things that are. That you consider problematic, and nobody even takes your call or responds to an email, or you know, you can't get
process that's wrong, and no one's doing anything about it.
And on top of that, you're in a position where you're supposed to look over these particular issues, and you're not being allowed to. That's usually what I would consider from an HR standpoint a toxic environment.
Yeah.
Right. Like it's not like you know, somebody who's serving corn dogs probably shouldn't be worried about, you know, annual revenue of the company, right?
No, but within the company.
But if you're an executive,
at the corporate level, there's a lot of things that are, it's just like seeing little things like, oh, a process that's broken and you try to fix it, but nobody will listen to you.
Or
like,
let
things
you.
Things like that,
right. Or you see that, hey, we're having turnover in this area, you know, maybe we should at least look into it. And they're like, no.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I always bring this up because this is a perfect example of, because it's not that political, and it's a perfect example of a lack of emotional intelligence. The Scarlett Johansson incident.
Yeah.
I mean, people think that's a silly example, but think about it. If you had an agreement with your company, you know, you got an offer letter or whatever, and you got a bonus or whatever, you thought you were getting certain guarantees, performance bonuses under a certain parameter of doing business, and then the business changes those parameters, which is what happened. They didn't let Black Widow into exclusively in theaters. They put it on Disney Plus as well. And so what happened was that she just think she got enough money. We can argue as adults why that may or may not be true.
Yeah.
You sit down with that person.
Yeah.
Who's bringing you money, who's a major star, you know, and you talk it out with her and her people. What you don't do is release a public statement saying we paid her $20 million. I think she has enough money.
Yeah.
Why would any boss do that, you know? Even if you had minimum wage employees, why would you do that?
Right.
You know what I mean? Much less somebody who could put you on blast worldwide.
Yeah.
And then you try to sound like a strong person and you end up paying her. You end up cutting her a check anyway. Right. So now you look weaker than if you just would have said nothing.
Yeah.
You know? That's emotional intelligence. It's like, I'm going to have a reaction, you know? And instead of thinking about what I'm going to say.
Yeah.
Because this is what all of our listeners out there who have children. This is what you're teaching your children right now.
Yeah.
When your children have an outburst or something, or they say something inappropriate, especially if it's at like a public function or a family function, you correct them, and because you don't want them to become adults and do that.
Right.
You know, even if they were in college as adults, or even if they were in the military or whatever, this person's a CEO of a huge company that everyone's paying attention to.
Yeah.
So if that's what you're doing publicly, right? Because a lot of times people are like, you know, they put on a good public face, but internally they're really bad people. This is what he's doing publicly. This is what he's not ashamed of. You know what I mean? So then I'm like, oh man, what's under the surface?
Yeah.
If you have cockroaches crawling on your rug, I don't want to know what's under the rug.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, So that's big. And then, So back to the bill and stuff. I know we kind of cut it in half.
The bill is kind of gone. I mean, that's all with the bill. I think the other side, like you said, there's like other employees, I guess. Conservative Disney employees have a petition now saying, quote, "The company we love seems to think we don't exist or don't belong here. According to the petition, Disney shouldn't be a vehicle for one demographic's political activism."
Right. So, and this has probably come from the denouncement of the Florida bill and all the stuff since, right? And again, I'm not picking sides, but I get that's Chapek's fault because now.
Now
no one likes
mad
you.
At you.
That's what I said.
Yeah, it's but like, okay, so, okay, wait. First of all, let me pick this quote apart. Mm-hmm. Because Disney shouldn't be a vehicle for one demographic sort of activism. Mm-hmm. Nobody was advocating anything. They were just saying that they were hurt that Chapek didn't publicly denounce the bill.
Right.
And, you know, because... Now, they made it clear it was because the company made a big deal about focusing on inclusion and diversity and being more, supportive of the LGBTQ community and being that one of their three pillars. That was the reason why the cast members were upset.
Mm-hmm.
So they weren't trying to be like, oh, go this way, go that way, support this bill. So the fact that they're using Disney, saying that Disney is being used as a vehicle for activism, of political activism, is not correct. And then also...
Well, okay, go ahead.
The company we love seems to think we don't exist or don't belong here. Nobody said you don't belong there. Don't exist? What do you mean? Just because he doesn't call you out, oh, for all you other ones, we'll publicly denounce whatever bill that affects you. Is that what you want? Like, it just sounds stupid.
So, it sounds stupid because you disagree with their political ideology. Yes.
Because they have no problem. That's why they don't exist. Because you have, not that you don't exist, but Disney's not talking about you because what... There's no problem that you're screaming about. But then once you have a problem that you're screaming about, now are you expecting Disney to be quiet because you just told them to?
I think that's what they're saying. If you're going to, they'd rather have them do nothing than support one particular group. So they are, so this is, it's kind of like.
But they have nothing.
So let me put it, anytime something like this comes up.
Yeah.
I try not to get emotional, and I try to put the hat on. What issue do I support, right? So I support voting rights legislation because I do think that, you know, it does, you know, disproportionately affect Black and brown communities.
Right.
When you do...
redistricting.
Not just redistricting. Redistricting, yes. Redistricting, redlining for housing. We're doing things that are just making it harder to vote.
Yeah.
Is going to... People are doing that for a particular reason.
Right.
People don't do things that disproportionately negatively affect themselves. Yeah. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
So let's say that's an issue that I support, right? Mm-hmm. And if Disney were to come out if Disney were to come out for that policy, for voting rights legislation, and then people who disagreed with that legislation made a big deal, and then Disney denounced it, I would be saying the same thing that conservatives at Disney are saying right now. Do you see what I mean? I would be saying, like, because you're saying that they didn't make they don't have any issues. Their issue is that they don't believe that, you know, LGBTQ stuff should be taught to children according to the bill under a certain age in schools. That is their issue. And they just happened to be in Florida winning on that issue. Mm-hmm. So the fact that they happened to be winning in that state on that issue doesn't mean that that's not their issue. That's their issue. Mm-hmm. Today, right?
So these are parents?
These are cast members.
Who are parents?
Some of them probably are.
Okay, then go right to your congressman and ask him.
Yeah, but I mean, they could tell the same thing to LGBTQ people. Why are you attacking Disney?
Because Disney went out and publicly said, this is our mission, one of our three pillars.
Right.
And we did something opposite.
Right. So maybe, because diversity and inclusion can mean different things to different people.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You could say diversity and inclusion could just, a lot of people think it's just, like you said, a lot of people think of that as race. I have a lot of conservative friends who are very much anti-racist, but are also pro, you know, parents' rights bill in Florida.
They went on to say that it includes, like, they got rid of the, what do they call it, genderless uniform, right?
Yeah.
So female cast members can wear pants instead of skirts, whatever it is, they said. So they did particularly point out.
But I guess what I'm saying is that if I disagree with somebody's complaint, it doesn't mean that they don't have a complaint.
I don't even know what their complaint is. Their complaint is that Disney thinks they don't exist. Well, of course.
Well, yeah.
You're getting a paycheck, aren't you? Like,
if Disney came out and said we support Judeo-Christian values.
Yeah, right? Now they got to be like that, and then I know. But we support Catholics. Oh, we support Lutherans too. Oh, don't forget about the Mormons.
Okay,
they sound like the.
You're making the conservatives' point. They're saying we have a constituency. Mm-hmm. They're not mentioning our constituency. Now, you might say there's constituency, in my opinion, shouldn't get mentioned because you don't have any real issues. Maybe that's your opinion. But my point is from an HR. I look at things from an HR standpoint. Mm-hmm. It's because I had to tell somebody. Because I remember in HR, somebody, we had to discipline somebody for telling a Christian person that their religion was BS. Mm. Right. Mm. Now, does it matter that this Christian person may have made more money than the person that told him that? Does it matter that they might be the majority in this particular area? No. My opinion on that doesn't matter.
Right.
You have to look at it from a business standpoint. In a business standpoint, if you're talking about true diversity and inclusion, that includes people who disagree with things that you might think they shouldn't disagree on. Right.
Yeah.
And so for them to come out with a complaint, I'm not saying that I agree with their opinions.
Yeah, they're just saying Disney should stay out of the political area. So, okay, they said they'll stop donating.
Yeah, only under pressure.
Right.
And then they still are saying that when they'll take our money, we'll give it to them. The only reason they didn't give money to the LGBTQ causes is because it was rejected.
Right.
It wasn't because, you know, they're not giving to churches and they're not giving to, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, our child fund that we donate to them every month, that's a Christian organization. Mm-hmm. You know, they help children. It doesn't mean, you know, do we agree with everything under the ethos? No. We agree with helping kids, right?
Right.
So I don't want to lump everyone into one type of category, but I'm just looking at it from an HR standpoint. Yeah.
I still don't.
They have just as much right to complain as another cast member. But like we just
said, it's hard to say something that's not political. Everything's
political.
Even though what Disney's doing is not even political. It happens to be a bill. They have to announce it. Okay, fine. But they're not trying to be political. And the other cast members are saying, oh, stop using Disney as politics.
Right.
They're not even like, so, okay. So why didn't they come out and say this when Disney wrote a whole statement about Black Lives Matters, when Disney wrote a whole statement about stop AAPI hate? Why didn't they come out and say, whoa, what about us?
Like I said, maybe they agreed with those issues. I don't know the individuals personally.
Well, then they're using issues too.
No, they're saying, you know what? Maybe stay out of all of it, because if you're going to support this, maybe they just feel really strongly about this issue. It's kind of like you said in two podcasts ago, you're not going to stop using an iPhone because of kids making them in China. Well, that issue didn't rise to enough to ire you.
Right, right.
So maybe the other issues didn't rise, and this one did.
Yeah.
So you guys are the same.
But they didn't say this. They didn't say that. They didn't say, as parents.
Well, I didn't. This is just a clip. They may have. I don't want to say. Yeah. I don't want to, you know, I didn't
what
do a personal
What they should have said was, as parents, yeah, we don't. It seems like we don't exist because we are parents and we don't believe our children should learn about, you know, LGBTQ issues in fourth grade or whatever. Mm-hmm. Then say that. But don't just say, oh, they're acting like we don't exist.
Well,
we have a petition now.
That was an I feel.
I don't even know what the petition.
That was an I feel statement.
Yeah,
and you know, and,
yeah, I facts. Feel.
But but let's be realistic. Most of our conversation just now, you were using emotion.
No, I was using. I was reading the thing.
Right, which is not incorrect.
First of all, what is the petition asking for?
For them to stay out of politics.
That is so vague. Like you said, I can say I'm a vegetarian and you're going to be like, says, oh, that's so political.
It says don't support any demographic. That's what it says.
So don't sell any more rainbow stuff in
maybe,
the parks.
Maybe if that's how they feel.
Well, then that's whatever.
Yeah. That's pretty specific.
Yeah, good luck getting that signed.
Yeah, you okay? But see, that's emotional responses, right? I'm not saying you don't have a right to be emotional. What I'm saying is that if you're going to be emotional, don't blame someone else for being emotional. That's
well,
all I'm saying.
No, I'm just going to use Baffling. Like, oh, let's see how your 10,000 signatures
right.
come out.
But that's not, you know. And then if
that's facts, if they have 10,000 signatures, well, I'll see how many signatures they get. I'll follow up.
You'd be
on
surprised,
this.
You know. There's always a pendulum. And things go back and forth. And, you know, there's going to be bills that you don't understand how they passed. So obviously, you said, well, I don't know that what good that 10,000 signatures is going to do. Well, people of like mind passed a bill in Florida that you disagree with.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So don't get cocky. You know.
But Disneyland and Disney World is full of like stuff that's like
yeah,
pride stuff. They sell rainbow merch, they have Pride Day.
So if I was an attorney for them,
stop doing all that.
If I was an attorney for them, I would use that as exhibit A, B, C, D to their complaint. They can now say, this is why we feel that our opinions and our values don't matter, because you're supporting this demographic.
I'm going to say, when you say don't use political whatever, don't be political, that's vague. Anything can be political now. And like you said, I can say I'm a vegetarian and people think that's political.
Right.
So,
well, it's not like this is a lawsuit. So I don't. They don't have
right,
to be.
But if you were arguing in court and making them do this, like, oh,
if,
well, first of all,
I guess
this is vague.
My
we
point
would never
is,
write a policy
my
like
point
that.
Is that there's many groups, liberals and conservatives, when they go to court, they do have a list of things, and they're long. So this is just cast members.
Yes.
These aren't attorneys.
Right.
These aren't people.
And
who,
what I'm saying is, Disney would never do it, because how can they write such a vague policy into their corporate minutes or whatever?
Well,
like, oh, we won't be involved in politics anymore. That's like that.
You're taking a complaint.
Right,
you're taking a complaint and you're making it very concrete. I think that
because the complaint has to be concrete in order for if what is your demand? Give us your clear demand.
Do you think
like Scarlett Johansson, give me money because I lost money?
Yes, but if somebody makes a complaint and says there's a toxic work environment, if somebody says I feel harassed at work.
Well, give me examples.
Yeah, that would be Disney's job, right?
Right. Right.
Okay, now I'm going to go back and ask you, what are your examples of blah, 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 blah?
Mm-hmm.
If Disney, so the complaint was actually, from a legal standpoint, from an HR standpoint, kind of smart, because it's forcing Disney to now ask them, okay, what are your complaints? And they'll probably already have them ready.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what are your demands or whatever?
Right, you know? Or if Disney doesn't do it, it says, this is why we feel they don't exist. We made a complaint. Disney didn't even bother to ask us what our complaints were. I mean, it's actually pretty shrewd. I mean, mm-hmm. it's not. I'm not saying I agree with them. I'm saying just from a standpoint.
Yeah, because they feel like they don't exist, so they need to do something controversial to.
If you feel like you don't exist, you want to prove that you don't
that
my point.
Exist. Yeah.
So. If your attitude is, because this is
if
the first.
This is the way for you to get attention, because if you don't exist, it's fine. Go ahead. Sign
attention.
Your petition.
So we already obviously know where you stand.
Everybody already knows where I stand ever since the beginning of the pandemic.
I know. But yeah, it's like any investigation that we would have to do. Somebody says, you know, so-and-so, you know, people are leaving early. This person, the supervisor is treating us horribly, or this. It's the organization's job to then go back and ask for names. We can't just say, oh, they didn't give us any names. So, you know, I don't know why there's a class action shoot now. Just because they gave those names to the EEOC and not us, you know, it's our responsibility to now ask.
Yeah.
Okay, what are your issues, right? So we'll see what Disney does. And if they don't do anything, it proves their point that Disney doesn't think they exist. I mean, from a legal standpoint, that's what I'm saying. I'm just saying that's how the game is played. That's what I'm saying. Hate the player, hate the game.
I know. I just don't understand what basic human rights were taken away from them. That's all. But like you said, you their parents, know. They're saying, oh, our rights as parents for right. our kids not to that. Have to go to school and hear about, you know, stuff we don't want them to hear about or something.
That could be it.
Well, then go to private school.
And that's now that's elitist. No, Tracy's forcing us to go to private school and spend $20,000 a year. I'm kidding. You know, I have to play devil's advocate because, you know, you get
wound up. The Catholics go to Catholic school. And if they don't want to, you know.
And that's what they used to tell black people. That's what we call separate but equal, Tracy. This has already been decided. Okay? That's why you always got to put on the opposite hat before you act out emotionally.
Like I said, it's fine. They feel like they don't.
It's fine.
It's fine because they feel like they don't exist. So now they need to do something to get attention. And we gave them their attention. It's cool.
I think
now are you happy now?
There's a meme right now on the internet that says, it says three things that men need to know when they know they're in trouble. Mm-hmm. What their wife says. Number one, it's fine. You know what you did, and never mind.
Yes, that's what it is to the employees. It's fine. You know what you did or didn't do. And
it's so funny. What's really funny is that you're
I'm trying to empathize, right? I feel sorry for them because I think they don't exist or whatever.
You're being sarcastic now, which is really funny from a ex-conservative.
Ex-conservative.
Maybe we'll tell people stories later. On our 200th episode edition, we'll go through some Tracy history after a few drinks.
No, you're
going
to get me canceled. I don't want to be canceled.
Hey, you could be like Chapek.
See, I don't like cancel culture either, so see? I didn't think, what's her name, should have been fired.
Who?
That lady from The Mandalorian.
Oh, Gina Carano?
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, she shouldn't have been fired.
No.
So see, that's not like radical left-wing.
Believe it or not, this isn't even the most controversial Disney news this week.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh. Talk about like weirdos.
Okay. Well, it is probably the most controversial, but it's not
maybe
the most blatant,
have,
I guess.
Maybe they should have signed the petition to help the high school, these employees here. So, anyways. So, Disney PR nightmare part two.
Right.
They had to issue a statement apologizing because, so, you know, Disney World always has these high school bands, marching bands come perform with the parade. And this particular high school called Port Nishi Grove High School marching band at Magic Kingdom. So before they are to perform, they're supposed to send audition tapes to Disney. And Disney's supposed to review and approve them. So the first thing Disney says is that because their mascot is the Indianettes. So Disney's like, no way, you're not wearing that war bonnet thing. They call it a war bonnet, I think.
Yeah, it was like a headdress.
Headdress. So like, nope, you can't wear that. So that's one requirement. So they didn't wear their normal uniform. Like, they wore just the uniform, but not the whole headpiece.
Right.
And then the drill team sent the audition tape, and they're like, okay, this audition tape looks cool. Go ahead.
They were supposed to perform.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
But instead,
I think they did perform, but the songs that they were supposed to perform, and
or
they just
something.
Added.
And they added, the Indianettes drill team was not allowed to wear the war bonnets, but still performed a parody of Native American dance and songs, including a scalpum chant. Yeah. And they did the parody. We watched, and it was really cringy. It was kind of like, you know, really cringy. So Disney was like, oh, my gosh, this was not the tape that they sent us. This was not in the audition tape. Mm-hmm. And so Disney had to go out and apologize. It was really cringy.
Yeah, it was. it was pretty bad.
So see, I mean, cast members on the other side, you do exist.
Other side of what?
The ones with the petition.
We don't know.
I don't exist petition.
One issue doesn't mean somebody believes in another.
Right. Yeah, okay. I'll compartmentalize.
Yeah. It was cringy. Here's the thing that I heard. I haven't confirmed this, but from what I've heard from other people is that they've been performing at Disney for years, and they've done that chant for a long time.
Just nobody's noticed.
So I don't know if this is a. Now I haven't confirmed that.
Right.
But
that wasn't what their defense was.
Well, no. Well, there was this one lady who gave a defense, and she was from the school district.
No, in their official letter, they didn't say, we've performed this before, Disney, or something like that. They just said, hey, this is our 100 years of tradition, and we're not going to change. But they never said, we've performed these many times before at Disney, and nobody said anything.
Yeah, I haven't confirmed it, so I guess I don't want to, because if that is true, that blame kind of shifts a little bit.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
So now, yes, I don't know about the individual students, but at least the school district and the school officials, they're just like, yeah, that, you know, that's what we do, you know, like, you know, love it or leave it, kind of. Like, that's what we do.
Like, this is 100 years of tradition.
So if you don't like them for that, they're owning it. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what they said.
Yeah.
Some Native American groups have spoken out.
Yeah, the Cherokee Nation did write a letter to them.
Now, Cherokee Nation's huge because the Cherokee Nation has like 27 tribes.
Yeah.
I remember I had to remember them because I used to, when I did adoption, we have to, ICWA, the Indian Child Welfare Act, you treat fostered kids who are of Indian registered people totally differently than
other
American kids.
So they wrote something, and then that's when the school wrote back and said, hey, this is 100 years of tradition and we're not going to change it.
Yeah. And I don't know. I think they're a public school, but I can't confirm that.
I think they are.
Yeah. I don't know.
Oh yeah. Because they had the school district.
So if they're a part of a district. Yeah. So, I mean, I guess the people and parents in that town are okay with that, I guess. I don't know.
It's in Texas.
It's in Texas. Yeah, maybe. it's, you know, it's weird because I guess it's one of those things where, for one, it's like it seems to be like one thing after another for Disney.
Yeah, so strange.
Yeah. As far as this particular,
or is it like people just looking for something?
Well, it's kind of like, so like, then this kind of, I was thinking about the other day. It's like, are people just noticing things more that have been happening?
Yeah.
And here's the thing, like, and I'll put this on just something I was thinking about. So there, you know, like the, Asian hate attacks, right? Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of those people who have attacked, elderly Asian people have been African-American, right? And a lot of people don't mention that, you know, because they're like caught between two issues. I don't want to, you know, degrade this one group. And to me, it's like, you don't have to. I mean, maybe that's just my HR background. Right. Like, you can walk and chew gum at the same time, right? It doesn't, because you're pointing out that a black guy knocked out an old Asian lady is not wrong.
Yeah.
You know, that doesn't offend me as a black man, you know, and you could still support, you know, African-American rights and everything else.
Yeah.
Those two things are
actually that probably brings up another issue that people should focus on, which is mental health.
Right.
Because the people who are attacking
Asians, that'd be a third issue.
Are mental health, you know.
Yeah, a lot of them are.
Which are being ignored.
So, but I was thinking, it's like, are people just noticing this now? Or what happened? Was there like an alien mind control thing that just now is a problem? Or has this been happening for decades?
It's always been there, I think.
And then people just now started reporting.
Yeah.
You know?
Recording.
And recording, yeah. And so I'm wondering, kind of back to this issue with the drill team, it's like, is it just now that people said something, and have they been doing this for years? Or not just them, by the way, but has there been certain just performances and stuff that are
way more offensive?
And now just the culture changed, kind of like a rug pull, and everyone now is just reporting it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I don't know. So
maybe.
I kind of feel bad because, and here's my empathy, and I don't know. It's like, I guess you could be a girl on the drill team and say
that was your routine.
That's your routine. But do you say I'm going to boycott this drill team. I'm not good. I made the team. I tried out.
But you wouldn't even know to say that because that's
they're high schoolers.
They're high schoolers, and then they don't.
And they're probably in a small town. Texas town.
Yeah,
you know?
Even that. It's like
so.
It's
even if you're like, against it, I don't even know if we do.
You wouldn't even know it was offensive.
But
that's
now it's like I think the scrutiny is going to be on these girls. When
it's the district that's... When
the district and Disney. It's like you have these entities that are way more powerful than teenage girls. And
they didn't. They probably don't even know what's wrong. Like, what was wrong with that? You know, they don't know. And then that's the thing. That's why it's like the ignorance, right? They don't know. But then once they do, they're probably like, oh, I didn't know that, you know? Like, because that's what they grew up in and, you know.
And even if it's, and it might not be wrong. They might have Native Americans in their school who don't care, you know, and have never said anything.
Yeah.
I mean, that doesn't mean that they don't care.
Right.
But they just may never, nobody's ever spoken out about it.
Right.
And so if you never speak out about something, how would somebody who's 15, 16.
Yeah. How would they know? Their parents probably don't even know, you know,
or don't care, you know. Yeah. So I guess, and this is probably gonna sound controversial. It's like I don't like blaming kids, for stuff,
right?
Even though they're the only ones you're gonna see on video,
right?
You know, besides that one old lady who was talking, you know, making a response.
Oh, there was.
Yeah,
I couldn't watch it. I'm like, gosh, this is bad.
So I think that's what I kind of have a problem with more than anything because. I see some things like this, and then like one of these girls are probably, some of them are probably applying for colleges and doing this stuff, and they're going to get on with their life, and are they going to be judged by this? And because of parents and districts, and yeah, because that's, you have to understand, people are already getting acceptance letters for colleges.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, we learned this in Spider-Man No Way Home.
I was going to say Spider-Man.
Have we learned nothing from Peter Parker in Mysterio? Controversy can keep people out of MIT, man.
Yeah.
And I would hate to see that happen.
And then 90% of the time, those girls are probably doing something good, right? So the only 1-10% where you saw this video is what screwed
For all we
lives.
Know, they're feeding the homeless on weekends and stuff. We don't know. I don't know. I mean, obviously, it was cringe to me. Obviously, Native Americans who are offended by this, I get it. If they were doing, you know, something that was stereotypically, you know, African-American in a negative way, I would be upset.
Mm-hmm.
And but at the same time, let's hold the adults responsible, whether that be at Disney, whether that be at the district, whether it be both. Don't take out your ire on teenage girls. That's that's all I would say. You know, I know but they're the ones you see on video. So it's hard not to do that. But, you know, we have to be the adults, right?
Yeah.
So if no one else is. All right. Can we talk about.
It's Taste Talk with Tracy. Mash some magic in your mouth.
Yay. We got a sweet item at the food festival, which we rarely do. But it was highly recommended. So we did the Snickers Caramel Macarons.
Yeah.
It's Snickers Caramel Peanut Milk Chocolate Mickey Macaron.
Yeah. It was very good.
It's like a Snickers with the macaron cookies sandwiched.
And I typically don't like chocolate gooey stuff. You know, it wasn't a hot day, but it was still sunny and stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm just kind of like, to me, those are like winter treats. But
yeah,
it was good. It was good enough to like still be good in the hot weather. You know, it was. I liked it a lot.
Yeah, so. it's literally like a Snickers.
Well, it's better than a Snickers.
Yeah, with sandwiched between two macaron cookies.
Yeah. Remember, you're always, with the peanut butter thing, you're always asking, why did they take away the cookie? Well, they put it in that.
Yeah, but this is only seasonal.
Snickers doesn't have cookies in it. It's peanuts.
Yeah.
This is like more like a Twix.
Yeah.
It's like a Twix, but with more, just more. You know, it's really good.
The other thing we got was at the same booth, this is the Nuts About Cheese booth, was spicy honey apricot cocktail that's made with rye whiskey, apricot orange, lemon juice, spicy honey syrup, and bitters. It was my first sip, it was spicy. I like coughed, like choked.
Mm-hmm.
But I eventually got used to it.
Yeah. It was something that I liked a lot. I don't think, now, like when I'm reflecting on it,
mm-hmm.
I can get why a lot of people, it wouldn't be their thing.
Yeah, because the spiciness.
Yeah, it's very spicy. But I like spicy drinks. I like.
It's not like mango nada spicy.
Yeah, though. It's not like spicy to where like it's like pepper spray.
Yeah.
It's just kind of, it's like, it's bitter.
Yeah.
It's more bitter than spicy.
Yeah.
But it's not bitter like that.
It's just like down your throat. But not spicy on your tongue where you're like, yeah. Like that.
But I think the thing is that most, like, it looks like other Disney drinks. Mm-hmm. So you look at it and your mind like, thinks sweet.
Yeah.
And then it's not.
Yeah.
So I think that's what, I think if you go into it thinking it's like going to be a little, because it's not super bitter. Mm-mm. It's just bitter for a Disney drink.
Mm.
And I think if you go into thinking, hey, this is going to be bitter, you're going to really like it. Mm. So I think that's kind of, it's the expectation of it. But I will recommend it, but I'll just put the caveat on it is does have some a bitter taste.
Spice, yeah.
Some bitter, you know, and a little spice.
Yeah.
On it.
But overall, we really liked those two things, especially the Snickers macaron.
Absolutely. All right. Now it's time for...
Christopher Lloyd will join the cast of The Mandalorian 3.
He's like 90?
I don't know, because I just saw Back to the Future the other day.
And Back to the Future was in the 80s.
Yeah, and he was old. Already old. I'm like, hey, isn't he really old? But I don't know. He looked okay.
And I just
okay
saw
in
him in a, I forgot what it was. It was like
I'm going to Google this. How old like is Christopher Lloyd?
It was like, I don't know if it was Jack Reacher. It was some action movie or something. And, He was basically like in a chair, but he just blasted people with shotguns. Like he was just, he was still doing action stuff, man. So it was pretty cool.
Hold on, I gotta.
But you're looking him up. Yeah.
Oh, he's only 83.
So maybe he's just one of those guys who just always looked old.
Yeah.
And he wasn't.
Dude, he looked 83.
So he must have been like in his 50s, like in Back to the Future. Yeah. Yeah, interesting.
Okay, anyways.
But that's pretty cool. He's you know, I always liked him as an actor, so.
I wonder if he's going to be like an Empire or a something or somebody good.
Yeah, all these, all this stuff. You know, let me skip to the, since we're keeping it Star Wars, I'll go to the next Star Wars thing. Is that the Cal Kestis Legacy Lightsaber is coming to Galaxy's Edge.
On March 25th. In both parks.
Now, a lot of people would be like, who? Yeah. A lot of people are like, who?
I was like, who?
Mm-hmm.
I heard of Cal because they were predicting that that's who would show up to the Baby Yoda
thing.
Well,
it was speculation.
Of, yeah, that's what the speculation was, but instead of...
And only a nerd, only super nerds with this saying that. Nobody else knows who Cal is.
Yeah, because people are like, no, it looks like...
So Cal Kestis is basically the star, the protagonist of Jedi Fallen Order, which is a video game. Mm. It was the last big Star Wars video game from, I think it's from Activision. I actually have it. I just haven't played it that much. But it was a big hit. The video game was a big hit. But you rarely ever see video game stuff cross over into the live action, you know, types of things. And so that's why this is a big deal. Because why would Galaxy's Edge... you know, release a legacy lightsaber, which they're pretty expensive, right? Those things are at least, they're like a minimum of 200 and then they go up from there.
Mm-hmm.
And why would they do that? And only people who, you know, that's a lot of production and everything. And only people who are can buy a Disney ticket can get it unless they're selling it at the trading post.
Mm.
I don't know. They might. Mm. But unless this is going to be something that people are going to really, really want in the future. Why would people really want that?
If it's a video.
Because if not, why don't you just give the license to Hasbro and they do a Black Series and then everyone just buy it at Target?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I don't understand why they're making this a Disney exclusive unless...
He's going to show up.
Unless he's going to show up.
In Obi-Wan or Mandalorian or Ahsoka?
He could show up in all three.
In all of them. Or some of them.
Because he was basically... Cal Kestis, just a little rundown, was a Padawan. He kind of has the same story as Kanan Jarrus in Rebels.
Mm-hmm.
He's basically a Padawan.
Who was his master?
I forget his master's name, but he was killed in Order 66, like just all the, everyone else. He was a Padawan who escaped. And then he was working in the shipyards. Mm. And then the Inquisitors come looking for him. And then, yeah, so he ends up finding another Jedi whose Padawan was turned to the dark side. So it's a pretty cool story. He ends up fighting Darth Vader, not very well, but Vader's kind of smacking him around in the game. But if they make him canon, because the game was so popular, I think a lot of the Star Wars nerds would be really happy if he was, if he came into the live action.
Yeah.
And as far as Obi-Wan, they said there might be a few Jedi that appear because there's another deal. The most popular game in recent history in the 2000s, you know, since the millennia, was also Jedi Force. I think it's called Force Unleashed. I think I played the first one. And then they have Starkiller. And they think people are saying he might show up. Hmm. And he was a secret Padawan of Darth Vader's. But none of this is made canon, right?
Yeah.
It's not canon until it's on the screen.
Right.
So we'll see. But he was a really cool character. So was Cal Kestis. And so we'll see. And there's a lot of room. And I think Filoni, you know, might move forward. He's the type, Filoni and Favreau are the type of guys who would move forward with things that are from comic books because they've already done stuff from comic books. So why not do stuff from video games?
Yeah.
So.
Okay, the next one's yours too because I can't pronounce this person's
name. Yeah, you could tell when I do the dot points because it's all Marvel and Star Wars. But So Peter Lotsek, and he is a voice actor.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, he said he's working on a new movie. So why is that a big deal, right? Mm-hmm. Well, he's the voice actor for Loki in Germany. So what happens is that just the same way things come to us, like if you watch anime or if you watch Squid Games or whatever, and you don't use subtitles, you get an American or an English-speaking actors and actresses to, you know, dub those voices.
Mm-hmm.
So they do the same thing in other countries with our films and stuff. So he's the one who would, you know, speak German for Loki.
Right.
You know, when the Avengers or the Loki series is in Germany. Mm-hmm. And so when he's saying he's working on a new project, well, that means everyone's saying, well, that means Loki's in a new MCU movie.
But he could be the voice of Thor in German.
He could be, right? You could. That's the thing. He could be something doing something else. But he said it was an
Marvel
MCU project.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. He said it was a movie. So why that? So if it was just like, well, I'm working, and you know, again, because we already know there's going to be a Loki season two.
Mm-hmm.
So if he just said that, that's not a big deal because then that just means he's just doing what we thought he would be doing is dubbing for a TV show. But he said a movie, and he said an upcoming, like new movie. And the only movies that are really upcoming are Multiverse of Madness and Thor Love and Thunder. Now,
Wakanda Forever in November.
Yeah, I don't see Loki appearing in that, but maybe.
you never know.
Maybe
he'll be Loki.
Because he's Loki's dad. He is Loki. He's Loki's voice in Germany.
Yeah.
So that's what, you know.
Well, if it's Doctor Strange, it's too late that he would already have worked.
That's what that's what a lot of people are thinking, because he would have already, they don't do the dubs at the last minute.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
And when you say he's working, it could be Thor.
But it could be, it still could be, because, you know, Multiverse of Madness, they could still be in the dubbing process. Because it doesn't come out until May 6th.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be Multiverse. I think it would be, I'm hoping it's more Multiverse, because then at least it ties the timeline Multiverse stuff up with the other Multiverse stuff.
Yeah.
And I think that would be a good, you know, tie it together. Because right now those two things are kind of separate.
Yeah.
And everyone's always talking about Kang when, you know, and I think they're two different things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's just my thing. I think timelines are different than different multiverses, right?
Mm.
Well, different universes. But who knows? They might tie it all together. It makes more sense that it would be Thor because that's he's a Thor character.
Yeah.
But at the same time, if it is Thor, I think it would be like one of those mid credit or after credit scenes because we already know how Loki was left in the series.
Yeah.
So for him to just, and we already know that Thor's dealing with a bunch of different gods. There's a lot of going on in that movie.
Mm-hmm.
So for him just to pop up and be like, hey, brother, you know.
Yeah, I'm back.
You know, get help, you know. That would be weird. But if he kind of like popped up at the end, like, I need your help.
Yeah.
Or to somebody.
Yeah.
And, you know, I need your help with Kang or something, you know.
Yeah.
Like in a mid-credit scene, I think that would be kind of cool. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, guys, we talked about politics again. And I know that's, you know, it is what it is. It's, mm-hmm. it's sometimes we do, sometimes we don't, but we try to take both sides of an issue. And, but we talked about Turning Red last week and I still like that movie a lot.
Yeah, me too.
So go see it. And, this is a little taste of it. I want to end on a positive note.
Is this Fort Town?
Yeah. We just want you guys to know where you're ride or die.
Like you. Had friends and I've had buddies. It's true, but they don't turn my tummy.
So you bought jeans that go with this song.
What? Don't make fun of my jeans.
Like you.
Oh. Bop your head, baby.
You never know on my mind. Oh my, oh my. I'm never not by your side, your side, your side. I'm never gonna let you cry, oh cry, don't cry. I'm never not be alright, oh I'll die, alright. Let's call it what it is, it's a masterpiece. Got a whole lot of love for them city streets. Tonight is the place to be. Got a big boombox and a new CD. Come on, everybody, let's tear it up. If you want mad skills, you can share with us. I want everybody to stop and stare. And you know why, it's me, Robert. Woo! Yeah. Let's go! You never not on my mind. Oh my. Oh my, I'm never not by your side, your side, your side. I'm never gonna let you cry. Oh,
remember, this is our last time. Well, our contest ends, giveaway ends Saturday. Make sure to send us those direct messages.
Yes.
And, ooh, everybody, tell Christina to stop bullying me. We'll try to make next episode, because it's going to be our pre-wedding
rope
dropping knowledge. So we'll try not to do anything too negative.
Yes.
And just remember, will your ride or die? All right. I'm Brian.
I'm Tracy.
Stay magical.
Bye.
Thank you for listening. Be sure to like and subscribe and visit us at www.ropedroppingknowledge.com.